There is a National Defense Academy. There is an Indian Military Academy. There is an officer's training. Each is different. Each is meant for a different purpose. Though the sum total is the same, commissioning finally takes place in the Officers Training Academy and the Indian Military Academy. Now, what is the subtle difference? In our army or the armed forces, we need a core cadre and a support. There is something called a core cadre. Core is the basic cadre, which is a permanent cadre which will remain. And the National Defense Academy provides bulk of the core cadre today. And as and when I think certain reforms take place, more and more reliance will be on the National Defense Academy to provide the core cadre. Certain other cadres and selection systems or entries do take place directly into IMA and OTA. OTA, of course, is there. IMA, I think they're looking at closing down. I'm not sure whether they've closed down yet or not, but they're looking at closing it down. And OTA, of course, will remain. Now, these any lateral entries, direct entries, are normally a support cadre. Normally. I'll say that again. Some changes in policies keep taking place, and there are some, areas which are gray because of change in policies. But there are support cadres like this, like Officers Training Academy is definitely a support cadre. And you will get permanency a little later. Now, the why I'm raising this issue to you today is whether you join the National Defense Academy or a direct entry cadre or go through short service commission through the Officers Training Academy, I do believe each one can excel and do well. It's a matter of how you take life. I don't think there is anything which is dramatic about the National Defense Academy which you can't achieve in 1 year or 1.5 years of training at IMA. Yes, there is much more time in NDA. The grooming is much longer over a 3-year period. They do get a BTEC degree and whatnot have you. But the point at issue is, you can be as good as anybody. So therefore, whether you go for the Officers Training Academy or you go to the Direct Entry Cadre or the National Defense Academy, it shouldn't be a psychological issue in your mind. And if you work hard, prepare, do your work well, you will excel wherever you are. And I've seen a very large number of short service officers, people in our army, who have done exceedingly well. So take it out of your mind that, okay, if I'm going to OTA, I'll only rise to a colonel or maybe a half colonel, and that will be the end of my career. And therefore, you start at a disadvantage in your service because mentally, you have let yourself down. I don't think you should do that. That is why I'm raising this point to you today. Academy. When you come to, whether it be NDA, IMA, or OTA, what are they meant for? Just try and understand what I'm trying to say. For an average person coming straight from homes, there are very few NDA guys, very few people from Sainik schools, military schools, and RIMC. It is the average lot who has to be made fit. So from an average, all people who leave the portals of these final finishing academies have to be made fit from the military point of view, not only physically, but mentally. So remember that. When I come to mental, the aspect that you should keep in mind is endurance is one part, robustness is the other. I will suggest find the difference between the two and you'll be that much more richer. While a soldier is expected to have a lot of endurance, an officer is expected to be robust. And that's what we look at in the academies. The second thing is, the attempt in the academies is to change a person from an individual way to a team way of thinking and functioning. This is a very, very important aspect of the academy. Everything is therefore designed to do things together as a team. Even punishments, some of us misunderstand. Sometimes punishments are given or extra duties and extra drills are given. 90% they are also collective in nature. Sometimes we misunderstand as to why this collective thing is being done. Remember, it is to build a team. And the team is only built under adverse conditions. And the academy places adverse conditions on you. And this is something that you must know so that when you go there, you are not disappointed and you feel, ye kya ho raha hai, what is happening? Everything designed in the academies is with a purpose. There are years and years of experience behind everything that happens in the academy. And mind you, they're all time-tested systems. If you accept them happily, nicely, and try and learn the positives out of it, it'll be a great thing for you in the future. Now, I come to a very, very major thing which the academies do to you. Have you heard the word discipline? I'm sure you would have all heard discipline. Try and define discipline to yourself as to what discipline is. But since we are on a webinar, I can't ask and get responses directly. I will only say this. Please understand what I'm going to say. Discipline is subordination of individual will to organizational will. The minute you learn to subordinate your individual, oh, why should I do this? It's not right. I'm not going to do this. The minute you start subordinating that to what is the organizational will and the organizational requirement, you are now becoming a disciplined person. And it's only a disciplined person who can maintain the ethics of that organization. And as officers, you are all going to be custodians of the ethics of our armed forces. So remember, discipline is very important. And the academies are designed to groom in you the aspects of discipline. Another important factor of the academy is, whatever you may say to start with, equal opportunities will be given to everybody, whether he is good, whether he is not so good. Equal opportunities will be given. It is for you to seize those opportunities, show that you are good, by working hard, and I'm sure you'll benefit out of it, because when the final, I will call it your order of merit is made, it will make a difference in your own seniority within your own group. So I think to that extent, you must know that opportunities to start with will be equal, but thereafter, you have to prove yourself that you are good. And this will remain whether you join the armed forces or you go into any walk of life, this factor, to my mind, will remain a constant. You will also be required to make a self-assessed choice where all the choices of the armed forces will be given to you and you will decide yourself as to what is the best for you. I'll come to certain other aspects of training. Any cadet or officer training cadet who joins either of these academies, whether it be NDA, IMA, OTA, or anyone else, broadly, very broadly, there are four things which I think I must speak to. I have always been calling them as four C's. Now, please understand what are these four C's. First is conduct. Second is competence. Third is commitment, and the fourth is character. If these four things are taken care of, you will understand what the academy is all about and what an officer is required to be, even whether he's in the academy or he's out of the academy and as a young officer. I'll come to them one by one. What is conduct? Conduct, ladies and gentlemen, are your personal behavior and personal habits. It's a matter of how you stand, how you walk, how you dress, how you talk, what kind of behavior you have towards ladies, how do you behave towards elderly, what is your sense of hygiene, and anything to do with your personal habits and behavior is contact. You will agree with me that if two people walk in front of you and one is shabby and unshaven and not clean, you may not ask him to sit down on a chair. But if there is another person who is well attired, well behaved, knocks on your door, asks for permission to enter, you will have some feeling in your mind that maybe he's a good enough person and I can ask him to sit down. Now, what I want to tell you with this illustration is conduct brings respect. If your conduct is good, your respect is guaranteed. If your conduct is not good, respect will be difficult to earn. And this goes throughout your life, whether it be with soldiers or whether it be outside. You can sample it for yourself, try it out yourself, you will find the difference. If you remain well-dressed, well-organized, punctual, your habits are correct, your decor with respect to your behavior with colleagues is correct, your instructors is correct, let me tell you, in the academies, your half the battle is won. Your instructors and teachers will like you. They will give you the respect that you richly deserve, and they will pull you up and you will do very well in the academies. It's a very, very important facet of training in the academy. Now, I have seen a very large number of young people who came to IMA did not have adequate conduct. And they were a little vulnerable. So obviously, their instructional staff who are there as platoon commanders and company commanders, they take a little extra interest and they are forced to get into the system of conduct. Sometimes they are forced. And those who regrettably do not improve despite the best efforts, well, they may have to find their way back home. So this is where you have to keep in mind that conduct is a very important facet of training. I will suggest that right from now, please start developing your conduct. Your shoes must always be polished. Your clothes must always be neat. You must be always properly organized and conduct in the best manner possible. Try and learn it from better people around. The next aspect is competence. Obviously, competence is a variable. Everybody is not as competent, but you can all try and. At the academies, the competence is something very, very important because in a short time of training that you have at the academies, you have to be given all types of training in that very less time, so that when you go to your units or whichever military organization you join, at least for the basics, you are as good as the soldiers and JCOs who are already there with years of experience preceding. That is the whole aim. Now, those of you who do not take interest in your training schedule or who do not make themselves fit enough to receive training which is being imparted because they are sleeping most of the time and things like that, or they are disinterested, or they think they can forget it now and do it later. Every type of person is there. I think they are wrong. You must take interest in the academies and go out of the academy confident that when you join your unit, you will be as good as the soldiers. Two things are very important. Firstly, is your physical fitness. No soldier of the Indian Army will accept or give respect to a person or his superior who's not physically fit. And therefore, I personally place a lot of store on fitness. The second thing is platoon weapons. You must know your weapons well. You must shoot as good as the soldier. and that's what they want. Remember all other things, they will forgive you. They may say it, that okay, ye saab seekh lega, baad mein seekh jayega, samajh jayega. But for lack of fitness and for your lack of ability to handle weapons, they will say ki he's not good enough. And that's the way it goes. So I suppose when you look at it, look at competence very, very seriously. The second part of competence is awareness, general awareness. At no stage in your military career can you ever tell your subordinate as an officer ki mujhe malum nahi hai, mujhe nahi aata hai. That will be your doomsday. And therefore, I suggest to all of you, read everything which is related to human administration, which is related to operations, whether you find them on the net or you find them on the YouTube or you find them in books and libraries. Try and read up. It'll be better for you. And make it a habit to keep reading. Even now, after retirement, I keep reading. So I don't think there is any shame in that. The other important aspect of competence is generate interest in you. Generate interest about the military services, the history of the military, the analysis of geography, because history and geography are something very important to the armed services. Because if you understand geography, geology, and things like that, half your battle in terms of managing things in certain areas will be resolved because you'll understand terrain much better. So create interest or generate interest within you to do some parallel reading and outside reading. Now, I will also come to the last part of competence. Whether in the academy or whether subsequent as an officer, remember that you have to be always ahead. Now, when I say always ahead means you have to be not only contemporary with what is the environment in which you are working, with all your equipment, tactics, what is happening in Iraq, what is happening in Iran, how are people fighting in various insurgencies. Until unless you are abreast with what is contemporary, you will not do well in the armed forces, or not do well in the right sense, that is, go up and earn the kind of respect that you deserve. And the same thing is with respect to when you are working within the army with your colleagues and all other officers, remember that you will earn their respect only if you know something outside the normal training which has been given. And when I say this, I'm going to amplify one small thing, which is a big weakness with us all Indians, is we are very fond of kunji learning. When I say kunji means a small pressy is given to you and you think that you have mastered the pressy and so you know it all. Let me tell you, that is bunkum. It's not correct. And unless you do outside reading on every aspect of human administration and operations, probably your competence will never be good enough. And conduct, I told you, brings respect. If a soldier finds an officer competent, he will start building trust. Because now he knows that this officer knows his job and I can put my life in his hands and he will take care of it. This is something very important that each one of you must understand. I will come to the third one, is commitment. Commitment is to the nation, to its people, to its culture, to its system, to the armed forces, to your soldier, to the flag, to your regiment. Now you have to be completely committed. You cannot be cribbing, I did a mistake, I joined this regiment and I could have done better there and things like that. Now this is all, I will say, it is all nonsense. Once you have gone, you have joined, you must work with pride and absolutely committed to the work which you have to do. You will be taught about commitment at the Indian Military Academy. a lot of store is placed on this aspect of commitment. But commitment doesn't come out of just simply somebody telling you. Commitment comes about by you building it in yourself that I will remain committed to the cause for which I have joined the armed forces. And again, I'll tell you here that when it comes to commitment, these soldiers, when they find an officer is committed and committed to his battalion, committed to his own soldiers and his command, the third element comes into them, and that is faith. So there was respect, there was trust, and now the third element is faith. They know very well now that this officer will stand by them in thick and thin, and that's going to be your commitment. So I suppose commitment is again very important. Develop in you as a habit, develop this quality in you as a habit, and you will do well, whether in the armed forces or otherwise. And I'll come to the last one in this is character. I will also say that look at character from a little different perspective. You all understand what character is. But as far as the academies is concerned, do not take chances with anything to do with character. Because if you are found wanting in character, then you have a very difficult time coming your way. In 6 months, I sent 7 young people home because of character. And thereafter, a lot of nonsense stopped. But it's not a matter of pride to have done that. It's something which I am trying to tell you, that academies are very harsh on matters of character. So therefore, remember a few things. You cannot lie. You cannot steal. You cannot cheat. It's something which is absolutely taboo in the academies. Now, besides that, you also have to look at those types of people who may not do mistakes related to lie, steal, or cheat, but they tolerate somebody doing it. Now, if the academy gets to know that you have hidden it and you have tolerated it, then that is considered very, very unofficer-like, and you may find the severity of punishment is the same. Because if the academy finds character glitches now, that means those character glitches will remain in your service even when you get commissioned. So here is a subtle difference between your selection system and the training system, and that is the selection system looks for your good qualities and selects you based on the qualities that you have. In the academy, a lot of focus is placed on looking at your vulnerable qualities. And if those vulnerable qualities are there and they are seen by the directing staff, then you will regret. It's not the best thing that can happen to you. Another thing, in addition to these 4 things which I have told you, what you have to know is courage and discipline is something very, very important. Courage is physical as well as moral. If the academy finds you vulnerable in courage, you have that much of a problem. And the same thing goes for, you know, in other than courage, that is your discipline. So there is no question of violating discipline or laid down instructions of the academy. And the last part about character, which I thought I must mention because it's not so evident, but later on it becomes evident, is competition. In the academy, you'll all be together, you'll all start doing things together, you'll all be equal. But gradually, as time passes, competition will develop between each other. Friction will develop between each other. A good person is who can get over it and who's not carried away by this competition, a competitive spirit, the wrong aspect of competitive spirit. And I thought I must warn you and tell you about this because I've seen it happen. And then they start bickering. Then they start cheating. Then they start complaining. Then they start doing all kinds of wrong things which doesn't make a difference because everybody can read through it as to what has happened. And finally, I gave you four aspects, that is conduct, competence, commitment, and character. Conduct brings respect. Your competence brings trust. Your commitment brings faith. And if you are a man of good character and your unit jawans know that you are a man of great character, other than the three preceding factors, you will get something which is called love. And then that's the first day you will realize that you are a worthy officer because his affection for you, his love for you will be seen in his eyes. That's the way our army works. And I wish all of you good luck to rise to that level so that you can earn the admiration and love of the soldiers you are destined to command as and when you go into the military services. Something about grooming. Grooming is not the aspect of what I wanted to touch today because I thought I'll focus on the academies. But since grooming is a major component, I think there is something that you must know. So I've just jotted down a few things. Now, grooming is an issue which is experience to vision. So the first step was knowledge to experience, that is in your training. And grooming is experience to vision. That means what you have learned in the academy and what you're going to learn in various courses of instruction subsequently, you're going to apply. And you're going to apply and convert it into your own personal experience. And remember that only the experienced can have a vision. People with just peripheral knowledge can never have vision. They can never be that good. So unless you experience, you will never be that good. So keep it at the back of your mind as and when you join your units. Not only learn and know, but also experience. And give a lot towards experience, you will do much better. I will also say that in grooming, what is very important for you as and when you cross that level of the training academy and go there is prepare one up. Whatever be your appointment, if you are a platoon commander, prepare to be a company commander. Means you should know everything about managing a company. And thereafter, be aware of what a battalion commander has to do. Now that is the manner in which you should groom yourself. So one up, you should be fully prepared. And two up, you should be generally aware. And that is what you should make yourself to be. And then only you will do very well. Now, that's all that I had as far as I'm concerned to speak to you today. If there are questions which any one of you would need to ask, you are most welcome. And I will suggest that don't repeat whatever has been said. But if there is something different, something bothering you, feel free to ask and I'll do my best to answer you. Thank you all for your patient hearing. I hope you have imbibed something of what I've had to say. And if you haven't understood any aspect, you can always leave it with Major Kalsi and I'll get back to him and reply my understanding of that. Thanks a lot to all of you. And now I'm waiting for your questions.
Jai Hind, sir. Thank you, sir.
Jai Hind.
Jai Hind, sir, there is one question for me.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Neha.
Thank you so much, sir.
I can read Neha here.
Hina Sheikh, sir. This is Hina Sheikh.
Neha, can you ask your question? Then I'll ask Shruti and then Amir. Yeah. Neha, are you listening?
This is Hina, sir, not Neha.
Okay, sorry, maybe.
Oh, yeah. Okay, sir. So, as you have earlier mentioned that IMA and OTA, the two different academies are for grooming officers for permanent commission as well as short service commission. But as now we have got the news that women can also taking consider for permanent commission. So what are the fundamental changes in the organization? As far as we are, we have to know. Can you throw some light on that?
See, there is no denying that I think the court orders are there and a permanent commission will be granted. And gradually, these directions of the or the manner in which the court order has to be implemented will be passed on to the academies. My suggestion to you at the moment as an aspirant is, forget about 20 years from now or 10 years from now. At the moment, your focus should be to get into the academy. And I'm sure the government has taken a decision. Supreme Court rulings are there. It's been a long process. The ladies have fought to get equal rights in the organization. It's a great thing which has happened. And now women soldiers are also joining. And I'm sure you'll all do very well. You've had a great history of women officers in our army. And I think it's going to proliferate into other organizations as well. And I'm sure you'll all do well. But for the moment, even I'm not so fully aware with the exact, in between to what orders have been issued and how things are happening. As a retired person, it's a little difficult. But I will keep a note of this, and Major Kalsi can keep a note of it and give you the details. But when it comes to the training of the lady cadets, to my knowledge, it is still continuing in OTA alone. It is not there in any other place. It is there in OTA at the moment. And I'm sure it'll now start finding its way into other places. But for the moment, it still remains confined to OTA Chennai. Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for your guidance.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, can I ask something, sir?
Yes, please.
Sir, according to you, who is best officer, sir?
According to me, who's the best officer?
Yes.
I think it's a good question. It's a good question. It may sound very frivolous, but to my mind, the best officer is a person who performs based on his capacity. What did I say? Who performs based on his capacity. You cannot copy somebody else. I have seen officers who want to copy some other personality, then they become confused personalities and fail. Don't get confused. Be yourself. Remember those four guidelines which I gave you, the four C's, and you will yourself become the best officer. Now, the best officer has one thing which is there in him, and it is very strong. And that thing is called self-pride. What did I say? Self-pride. In self-pride, there are, again, four things. A person with self-pride, remember, will always be fit. He will keep himself fit. A person with self-pride will always keep himself aware. A person with self-pride will always be self-disciplined because he doesn't want to be told off. He or she doesn't want to be told off. And lastly, a person with self-pride will always self-develop. Now, the common factor is self. Means a good officer or the best officer does everything himself and doesn't leave it to somebody else to do it for. Is that understood?
Yes, sir. Thanks for guiding me, sir.
Clear?
Sir, if I may ask one question.
Yeah.
So we say that in most of the organizations that we go to, I'm talking apart from armed forces, they always have this tendency to look at your past. And as far as I have known, armed forces is one such organization, which I think it is more in present than it is in past. But still, I have been to a few SSBs and I've seen this, that they tend to evaluate you from somewhere from your past experiences. So, sir, if we go forward for, let's talk about, territorial army, how much is past given a weightage? Past as in the way you have done academically or the way your experiences have been?
I have not really understood your question. Kindly repeat it again. I have not really understood. I know that you are asking it from the point of view of somebody who's appeared in the SSB a number of times. So you're asking from that perspective? Kindly repeat your question again. Hello? I think she's gone off the air. Can somebody ask any other question?
Yes, sir. May I ask? Sir.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah. You are audible to me. Please speak.
Yes, sir. Very good evening, sir. Jai Hind, sir. Sir, I want to ask.
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Sir, how can I come out from my comfort zone?
Sorry, I can't hear you. Say that again.
Sir, most of the citizens, I'm not from a military background. So how can I come out from my comfort zone?
How can you come out of your comfort zone?
Yes, sir.
Oh, I don't think it's very difficult, young man. Comfort zone is up to you to sacrifice. If you are sure in your mind about what you want, you will get it. This was taught to me long ago as a young person by a Subedar Sahab of mine. And you know what he said in Hindi? Jo mangoge, wo milega. Right?
Yes, sir.
When you demand, you get. You demand from yourself a certain standard, you will get that standard. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Now, you heard that.
Yes, sir.
To say I, you heard Major Kalsi say that I got the commando dagger. I was not the strongest. My God. I demanded from myself that I must rise to that level. Right?
Yes, sir.
And you should demand from yourself. I'm sure God will be with you. You will do well. And you'll get out of this comfort zone of yours.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. Jain, sir.
Thank you.
Good evening, sir.
I want to ask a question.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir.
One question.
Okay.
Shireen Singh, sir, I have one question. From your perspective, sir, how would you define strength of character? From your perspective, sir, I just wanted to hear that, which would give me confidence.
Okay. You see, I gave you certain things. Strength of character is a very, I will say, a very simple thing in this. When you look at a person of character, it is not the person as to what he or she is showing. It is as to what that person is. Now, strength of character emerges only in adversity. The true strength of character emerges in adversity. So I suppose if you have to assess somebody's strength of character, look at that person in adverse situations and you'll find a true, valuable person with the strength of character. Right. But yes, a simply stating strength of character is a person who does not espouse, but who believes in his own values. Right. You see, a large number of people are only talking about values. But when it comes to doing a certain thing, they may or may not. Or they may be slippery. They may be, let's say, adjustable, you know, manage the values. I don't think that is a man of character, a person of character. So a person of character is a person who does not espouse but practices his own or her own sense of values.
Thank you, sir.
Is that okay?
Remember that. Yes, sir. Good
evening,
sir.
Good evening, sir. I'm Madhu speaking from Delhi.
Yes, sir.
Sir, we usually heard that SSB usually looks on your personality. It doesn't depend on your past, that how much you performed well in your academics. Yes, definitely that gives you an edge. But it basically mostly depends on your personality. Mostly depends on personality. We repeatedly see here that it all depends on your personality, whether you're working or you took a drop or you're preparing or you're doing anything. So can you clear the what the personality?
Yeah, I'll clarify this to you. And to all the aspirants who are hearing me today, armed forces is constant reading and learning. Forget the factor some of you have in mind that you can get away, you know, only in the training and selection process you need to study. Let me tell you, till the last day, you'll be studying and studying and studying, because this world of war is so dynamic, so technological, so competitive, so diverse in its nature. The spectrum is so vast that if you are not good and if you do not study, and you only become good when you study, you will never do well. So in the academy, or let's say your selection process, there are two factors. One is the written test. The written test is to generally assess your academic capability. And the service selection board is to assess your leadership capability. And the two are combined in a certain format to give you an overall merit list. Now, this system of a written examination to test your capacity or knowledge capacity will continue in service. When you become in the training academies, there are tests and tests and tests which you will go through. When you join the armed forces, there are courses in which you will be tested. There are Part B, C, D examinations which you will be, you know, required to go through. And there is any amount of tests which you will have to go through, primarily to see to it that you are abreast and your knowledge level is abreast to the requirements of the day. Have I answered your question? So this will remain. There is no shortcut to it. You have to prepare yourself for your written, as well as the services selection board. It is not one facet, it is both facets together.
Sir, in your talk, you stated two words, robust and vulnerable. So can you please explain us what exactly the two words mean?
Your voice has gone down.
Sir, in your talk, you stated two words, robust and vulnerable. Can you please explain us the exact meaning of the two words, the robust and the vulnerable?
I wanted you to do your homework, find out.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
No, it is not vulnerable. I use two words, endurance and robustness.
Sir,
hello,
I
sir.
Have one more question, sir.
Sir, Jain, sir. How can we make a decision in a difficult situation, sir?
So, can I ask one question, sir?
I suppose before the lady can I tell somebody else on the line, yeah?
Yes, sir. How can we make a decision in a difficult situation, sir?
Oh, how can you make a decision in a difficult situation? Practice being decisive. What did I say?
Sir.
Practice being decisive. Right? And when I say that, I mean, how can a person be decisive if that person doesn't accept responsibility? And I'm sure Valoy Academy would have gone through the responsibility factor of SSB training in great detail. When you are a responsible person, you accept responsibility, and you can only be responsible if you start becoming decisive in nature. So decisiveness has to become a part of your habit. You have to accept the risks involved with decision. If you are scared of taking risks, you will never be decisive. Is that understood? Okay, next. There's some lady who wanted to speak before I cut her off.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Good evening, sir, first of all. So my question is, sir, it is very likely the fact that if a candidate has a very good academics and very good involvement in physical activities, sports...
No, your voice has gone down. I just can't make out. Yeah.
Am I audible? So am I
now,
audible?
Now better. Yeah, speak.
Okay, sir. So I was saying that it is very likely the fact that if a candidate has a very decorated academics in past and very good involvement in physical activities, so if a candidate has not so good...
You've gone down. I just heard a very academic something you said and thereafter your voice disappeared.
So I was saying that, so if a candidate has a very good academics and a very good involvement in physical activities or sports, so it's very likely the fact that the candidate has that an edge over the other candidates. But sir, if a candidate has an average academics and an average involvement in physical activities, which is mean like not at district level, state level or national level, just at the school level, so it's very natural among the candidates, many candidates, that they try to hide their flaws in the SSB interview just for us to get into that academy. So, sir,
I'll one thing.
Yes, sir.
Which you have to keep in mind at the moment.
Yes, sir.
Those of you who had better resources and better opportunities, which I mentioned in the start of my talk, and therefore, you achieve better education, your English is good,
yes,
your conduct has been developed in a public school, yes, and you know, large number of those kinds of things which are like, let's say, officer-like tributes have come into you.
Yes, sir.
You think you have an edge. Yes, you definitely have an edge. But mind you, Services Selection Board is not about just watching you speak something or say something or behave in a certain manner. There is something which is a hidden side of it, which is your psychological testing also. And somewhere down the lines, some of them could go wrong there, right? And therefore, they may not make it. I suppose if such a thing has happened to any one of you students, do not lose heart, for God's sake. Try and analyze your vulnerability, weakness as to what could you have done wrong. Be honest with yourself for a change. Number of young people come to me and ask me these types of questions over here locally in Lucknow. And I always tell them, be honest with yourself. Tell me what exactly happened in the SSB, then only we can help. I suppose there is a need for you to be honest with yourself. Whosoever has had a rough time in this manner, decide for yourself, because you may be very good otherwise, but you may not make it in the SSB because the strike has not been. Have you understood?
Yes,
so I suppose... Please understand this. Every time, this overconfidence of certain attributes may not get you through. Okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Right.
Hello, sir. I have one more question, sir.
Yes.
Sir, can I ask?
Sir, I wanted to ask you. You told me that a best officer should have...
Go ahead, speak.
Right, sir. So high self-pride, in that you told that he will keep himself...
No, I can't hear you. I can't hear you.
Sir, am I audible now?
Yeah, much better now.
Yeah, sir, best officer, you told he will keep high self-pride. And in that, there are four factors, fitness, awareness, and self-discipline. What was the fourth?
Self-development. Always develop yourself. Don't depend on somebody to... goad you to improve yourself. Okay.
Okay. Okay. All right, sir. Thank you very much.
Good evening, sir.
Excuse me, sir. Good evening. Sir, actually, how to? My question is that how to control the nervousness, because this will be my first attempt for FCAT after my engineering. So there is a bit of nervousness. There is much nervousness. So how to control that nervousness?
It is always there with everybody. If I come on the webinar today in front of all of you and start speaking, there is a degree of nervousness even with me. when I used to stand in the academy in front of 1800 cadets over there and address them on something, there is a sense of nervousness, right? It is common to all human beings. Courage is to overcome nervousness. And overcoming nervousness comes from two or three things which you should look at. Firstly is having knowledge. If you have knowledge, half your troubles are over. Second is realizing that you don't have adequate knowledge on that subject. So your behavior changes and you say openly and confidently, "Sir, I do not know a certain thing." And therefore, your nervousness disappears. But the minute your nervousness becomes something in which you start lying or telling wrong statements or doing something, then your nervousness will only increase. It will not go down. This is one way. The second way to look at nervousness, in my view, remember good things. Remember your parents. Remember your good teachers. Remember your good friends. Take a deep breath. Think of God. And you calm your nerves. That is very, very important, right? And last but not the least, look around. Why should you be in a competition with anybody? You are yourself. You are being assessed for what you are saying or doing. Why are you in a competition? Half the time, nervousness comes because you are placing yourself in competition with 13 or 15 others. Why are you competing? They are doing what they have to do. You do what you have to do. Am I right in saying that? So the minute you get this last aspect correct in your mind, that you are the best man, you know your limitations and your positive sides, and you are going to do your best, half your fear will go away. Why should that fear, which is causing you nervousness, remain? Okay? Now, this is something, you are doing it for the first time, fair enough, you are honest with that. But remember, stand in front of the mirror, speak in front of colleagues, try and get this nervousness and shyness out of the system. I have had a colleague of mine, he could sing beautiful Hindi songs. But when it came to speaking in front of five people, he would start, because of nervousness, start stammering. But he was marvelous, marvelous otherwise. And when singing a song, he would never stammer. Why? Now that same song he's singing in front of 500 people, he's got no issues. But when it comes to speaking something in front of somebody, he'll start stammering. Now, this means only one thing, that his knowledge base was not there. The knowledge base was, he was much more confident with singing a song, so therefore, there was no stammering. But when it came to a subject on which he had inadequate knowledge, the person would be in trouble. So half the time, I feel that the problem is related to your preparation, it's related to your knowledge base, and it's related to yourself putting yourself in an adverse position by getting into a sense of competition with people around. Is that okay?
Good evening, sir.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. Yes, I wanted to ask a question.
Yeah, please ask. Go ahead.
Sir, is there a book which comes to your mind that, like, is there a book which you think everyone should read at least once?
I think it will be very difficult to define as to which context you're asking for. If it was with respect to leadership, I could name. If it was with respect to military aspects, I could name. So there are different. If it is related to spiritualism, I will not like to name because I don't do so much of reading onto the spiritual lines. But I suppose there are huge number of books today. It depends on what your interest factor is. From which interest factor point are you asking me this question?
So, military aspect.
Okay. If I were to tell you at your level, that if you were to read, a book, then read a book called Infantry Attacks by Rommel. Have you heard of Rommel?
No, sir.
Rommel was
a
German general in the Second World War. He was a genius. He was a genius. He He was an absolute genius, right? Now, he wrote a very he wrote a book early in his life on infantry attacks. It will tell you at your level as to what a young officer must be in the armed forces, whether it be India or any other country. Okay? If I were to find an ideal book at your level, I would say it is that. If you want
Thank
to
you
understand
so much, sir.
Physics of force, forces mass into acceleration, then you must read a book called Race to the Swift. If you want geometry of war, then you must read Deep Battle. So there are any number of books, but I suggest that you read Infantry Attacks by Rommel to start. Okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you so Thank much, sir.
Pleasure. Good evening, sir.
What about a leadership qualities book? Can you suggest, sir?
Say that again.
Sir, what about a leadership qualities, sir?
Now, which leadership quality you would like me to cover? Or what is it that you're asking? Because leadership, there are huge things. There are a large number of qualities. I think you've been taught that in your SSB training capsule in the Valnoy Academy. Which specific area are you looking at asking? Ask? Hello?
Sir, if I may, sir. Sir, I'm a different person. Can I ask you something?
Where's the earlier person gone?
Sir, I don't know, sir.
He kept quiet. Okay.
That guy was asking for some suggestions of books to develop a good personal skills, skill development.
I can't understand. Please say that again.
That person was asking for suggestions of books to
he's not there,
for
sir.
Skill development.
Sir, I was asking, sir, you entered army, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, were you courageous enough? So, like, I think that I'm not courageous and I really want that. Develop courage, sir.
The very fact that you've asked me this question, I will place you that your courage factor is okay. You don't have to worry about courage, right?
Okay, sir. Okay,
now,
sir.
You're asking a personal question. I will say that I was a very, very lucky person right from the beginning. My father was also in the armed forces.
All right, sir.
And at the age of 8, I had a double-barrel gun in my hand and I could travel the jungles in Northeast and do some shooting and things like that all on my own. So I learned very large number of skills as a person in school. And therefore, I don't think that will be the right example for everybody to take because everybody may not have had those kinds of opportunities.
Exactly,
but
sir.
Yes, courage is something which is inherently there in you. It is only exposed to you. Put yourself in situations and you'll find. So do adventure treks, do adventure training. You'll find your courage coming out and you'll be very happy with yourself when you find yourself in circumstances. Okay?
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Good evening, sir. My
sir,
name is Deepika.
Okay, the lady cadet first here.
Sir, how likely is it for an territorial army officer to be a full-time officer in one of the academies? Sir? How likely is it?
Or see, territorial army is one of our best systems available in our country. Thank God for it. And I think it's a great opportunity for people in the civil world to come and serve in the armed forces. They all fall in love with it. I've dealt with certain territorial army units and their officers. Sometimes I've even found them better than the corps cadre officers of the regular army. They are so qualified. They are so technologically endowed. They understand everything and they have that sense of maturity of having dealt with people in the civil life. So I put a lot of store by the territorial army officers. Now, when it comes to their training, obviously their training is not as stiff as what is there for NDA or for any other academy. But their training, you can never say that they have been put into battle without being given adequate training. That is not correct. Sometimes training is also ongoing. When I say ongoing means, some part of the training has been covered, but because of the shortage of time, it is inadequate. So when they join units, further training is done. Like when I joined my battalion, I was, of course, lucky that I had a large number of attributes over there at that time. Not difficult. But despite that, my commanding officer felt that, no, you must prove yourself to the men, and you can't be hanging around with some glories or some medals which you have won here and there. You have to go and prove yourself with the men. So he sent me back into a thing called Umedwar Kader, which is from a sipoy to Lance Nayak, promotion Kader. It's a very tough Kader for young people. And then I had to stay with them for 3 months in the unit lines and along with the Jawans and rough it out with them the way they were. And that's the quality of life. And then you start actually liking your soldiers, your colleagues, your people. So I think it's a great thing. And I will leave it at that. So take life the way it comes in the army. Let me tell you, each and everything about the armed forces, there's something, some great history behind it. There's some great repertoire of knowledge behind it as to why those cultures, traditions prevail. And you can only gain from it. You cannot lose it. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. But the question was, how likely is it for a territorial army officer to actually be, is it even possible for the officer to be converted to a full-time officer in the armed forces?
No. For that, you'll have to go through the different process. The processes are different. Your terms of engagement are different, to my knowledge, right? So you cannot, to my knowledge, you cannot become from territorial army to a regular army unless you go through an entry process. When I say entry process, means what you're going through now. Come to appear for the IMA and then do your SSB and then go and join the IMA and then become a regular. Is that all right?
Yes, sir. Got it. Thank you.
Okay.
Sir, I got recommended for TS-43 course and I have to join OTAGI in next 10 to 15 days. So, sir, what are the things that a cadet undergoes in first few days of joining the academy?
I told you at a great detail. I explained to you certain things which will be happening. Your fitness will be the major thing, right? Your discipline. So actually your syllabus. Now, when I look at that, your syllabus is all related to weapon training, tactical training, administrative training, drill, PT, map reading, night marches, a whole lot of things which you will be exposed to. In the first few days, you will be generally taken around, shown around. Things will be a little easy. You will be medically tested. A lot of blood counts will be taken to see your oxygenation level in the body and things like that. And after that, you will be put into a process which is gradual, and then it will reach a certain level of your as per the requirements and the time factor which is there at the academy. They will put you in line. But let me tell you, the very fact that you have qualified, go happy there. It's a wonderful place, and along with your friends and colleagues, you will do very well. You don't have to get too worried about what will happen at the academy. It's nothing so dramatic that you are going to have been a lot of trouble. Nothing like that. And stop looking at nonsense that you will be under punishment and you will be there's that. Even that punishment, whatever little bit is there, is all fun. Take it like that. Please take it from me. It's for your good. It is building adverse pressure to see the best in you. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Right.
We won't be taking any more questions further. On behalf of Balnoi Academy and all the students, I want to thank you, sir, for taking out the time and for teaching us so much today, that most specifically about the four C's that I know as a matter of fact, I and everybody else here are definitely going to remember. Growing up, we've always been told by my father that your mantra for success has been pure excellence and do not allow status quo. So we will live up to your expectations that you have from us. Thank you for teaching us so much and for things that are going to go beyond the realm of just everyone's defense careers. And we are going to keep them with us for the rest of our lives. Thank you, sir. Jai Hind.
Jai Hind to all of you. God bless.
Thank you so much, sir.
Jain sir.